up the crown, rise on the praises, rest on the brow of the King of the ages. Raise up the crown, rise on the praises, rest on the brow of the King of the ages. Raise up the crown, rise on the praises, rest on the brow of the King of the ages. Raise up the crown.
Well, good morning. Hope you're doing well. Want to bring your attention to a couple things. We got a lot happening. A couple weeks ago, we had our No Grow Go conference. We still got some shirts and hoodies on sale in the FLC. There's a resource table back there with free books, Bibles for you to take home, to keep, to give to your friends, your coworkers. That's free to you. Also, on the other table is a deacon nomination form. So if you've got someone in mind that you think would be a great deacon to serve in that ministry, please fill out that form. Also, this month is Annie Armstrong Offering Month. So if you want to give to that beautiful ministry that helps push forth the gospel, please make note of that. Other than that, I think we're good to go. So let's stand. We're going to worship and sing to the Lord this morning. Responding to your word, the sky above and earth beneath, the garden from the dirt, Your voice ignites the galaxies, the tapestry of stars. In majesty, in gravity, you've shown us who you are. You're worthy, you're worthy. With saints and angels we will say, you're holy, you're holy. You gave your love to enemies, your son upon the cross. Blood he shed in agony has made a way for us. He's the image of your radiance, the imprint of your heart. In sacrifice, shown us who you are. Whoa. And all praise and honor to your name, 'cause you're worthy, you're worthy. With saints and angels we will say, you're holy, you're holy, God. We bow before the only one who was and is to come. And nothing compares to you. No, nothing compares. We bow before the only one who was and is to come. And nothing compares to you. No, nothing compares. We bow before the only one who was and is to come. And nothing compares to you. No, nothing compares. And all praise and honor to your name, 'cause you're worthy, you're worthy. With saints and angels we will sing, 'cause you're holy, and you're holy. And all praise and honor to your name, 'cause you're worthy, yes you are. Nothing compares to you. No, nothing compares. We bow before the only one who was and is to come. And nothing compares to you. No, nothing compares.
What a beautiful song. Nothing does compare with him. Amen. Y'all please be seated. If you would, turn with me to the book of Colossians. We'll look this morning briefly in chapter 1. Later on, our sermon this morning is going to be about specifically the relationship of the church with the government. It's a difficult and different passage that Paul addresses in the 13th chapter of Romans, and one that is potentially convicting to us as the church. But in the book of Colossians, Paul speaks about the Creator of all things, authorities, rulers, governments, and makes clear who is in control and who is our ultimate authority. Looking in verse 15, Paul says these words, He in this case is Jesus the Christ, He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn or the preeminent of the hierarchy of all creation. For by Him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through Him and for Him. And He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. And He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything He might be preeminent. For in Him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through Him to reconcile to Himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of His cross. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You that we know that we worship a God that is sovereign over all, that rises kings and rulers and leaders up, Father, and removes them all in His time, in Your discretion, and at Your will. Father, would ask that You would give us wisdom, that You would give us faith, Lord, to be able to follow and trust You even in times of difficulty, even in times that we don't understand, even in times of potential persecution or in times of challenge that seems to be brought upon us by those amongst us, Father. Would ask that You would give us clarity of thought, that You'd give us wisdom amidst confusion, Lord, so that we might follow You more closely, God. We pray for these leaders that You've given to us, Father. We pray for our leadership at our local level, Lord. We'd ask that You would give them wisdom and guidance. We'd ask that You would give them Your eyes and Your heart, Father. We pray for our leaders at a state level, God, as they seek to make decisions that are consistent with Your will, Father. We'd ask that they would search You out and seek You out. Lord, and we pray for our leaders at a federal level. Lord, we know that we don't always agree with the decisions that may be made, Father. In fact, sometimes we vehemently disagree with them. God, but give us the insight and the wisdom to know that our differences are not necessarily political or ideological, God. But what may separate us most, Father, is the fact that You have changed our hearts and perhaps not theirs, God. Give us that wisdom, Father. Give us the desire to reach out in love. Give us the desire to reach out in truth, not in anger, not in hatred, Father, but in the way You would have us to reach out, Lord, to all people whose eyes have not been opened to the truth. Oh, God, would ask that as we continue to worship and praise You, Father, that You would pour out Your Spirit upon us, Your grace on our life, Father, and we will be sure and certain to give You all the honor and the glory and the credit for all the work that You do. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Let's stand and continue to worship. Lost are saved, find their way at the sound of Your great name, and all condemned feel no shame. at the sound of your great name. Every fear has no place at the sound of your great name. The enemy, he has to leave at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. And all the weak find their strength at the sound of your great name. Hungry souls receive grace at the sound. Your great name, the fatherless, and they find their rest at the sound of your great name. The sick are healed, and the dead are raised at the sound of your great name. Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within. Upward I look and see him there who made an end to all my sin. One with himself I cannot die,
My soul is purchased by his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect, spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on him and pardon me. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on him and pardon me.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the beauty of the gospel that has redeemed and reconciled us, that has taken away our sinfulness, the wrath deserved because of our rebellion against you, Lord. You have removed through the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus. And it's in his name that we stand and sing. It's in his name that we walk in obedience throughout our life. Lord, not for our own good or righteousness, but because of Christ's righteousness. And we rest in that, and we submit to that. You are our Lord. And help us be obedient to all that you've called us to do. We thank you for the gathering of your people to proclaim and to sing your truth and to hear it proclaimed through your word. What a beautiful gift that you've given your people. We pray this in your beautiful name. Amen.
Amen. The Lord will speak to us today from Romans chapter 13, if you'll meet me there. We'll look at those words in just a moment. It was beautiful this morning to walk down the halls of this church and to hear Bible teachers expounding the Word of God. That's been a long time coming over the last year. But I was walked down the hall and I heard Scott Williams preaching truth, and I heard Beverly Bullock with the class next door, and she was proclaiming the truth. And then I heard Don McLaughlin's almost godlike voice echoing down the halls, proclaiming truth. And then I heard Joe Whitten, not Paul the Apostle, but Joe Whitten's eloquent voice proclaiming the truth. And it was then that I realized that the truth is going out from this place. And it's a beautiful sight to behold. So in Romans chapter 13, the truth will go out once more from this place. I'll make a general comment. It's not an absolute, but it's generally true. Bad government is better than no government at all. I'll go further. Wicked governments are better than no governments at all. That's what the Holy Spirit would have us to contemplate this morning. Scripture gives us, as Christians, counsel in how to relate to human governments. both local, state, federal, either one of them. And here is Scripture's counsel. Bad government is better than no government at all. Different forms of government exist in the world, but they generally fall into three categories. You have monarchies or dictatorships, kingships, if you will. You have totalitarian rule, and then you have republic government. The first, the monarchy, is ruled by a single head, typically a king, or in these days a queen in England, although there is some republic elements now in the English form of government. The totalitarian government is ruled by a small group, and the republic are a small, are elected officials actually govern the country, not a small group, but actually a large group. And those are the three basic types of government that exist in some form and have always existed in some form. Paul was writing to believers in Rome. Rome was in the process of moving from a republic to a monarchy with republican elements. Roman government is a fascinating study if you ever have time to look into it. I'll give you the Cliff Note version this morning. In 27 BC, Rome began to centralize power from a republic to a monarchy when Octavian, who historians call Augustus, was named the first emperor. He enacted constitutional changes to centralize power under one person, the emperor. That shift left some of the old features of the republic in place. For instance, the emperor held the lion's share of power. Under him, you've got the emperor. Under the emperor, you had two consuls who basically ran the government, ran the military. They made sure that the military was very strong. They were elected by the people, the two consuls. Underneath the consuls, you had a 300-member senate nominated by the emperor, but elected by the people. Their specific task was to manage the treasury, and they gave advice on legislation, although their advice held no legal force. It did bring with it some political pressure, but it didn't hold any legal force. That's the federal level. Now, locally in the Roman government, the empire was split into provinces, much like our country is split into states. Each province had a governor selected by the Senate. And finally, there were 10 tribunals. Each was a common citizen called a plebeian who protected the rights of individual citizens against the government. Now, complex, multi-layered system. It wasn't perfect, but its structure was centered on law and order. In fact, when we read the book of Acts, we see Paul the apostle cycle through those structures of government. For instance, Acts records that he appeared before the tribune in Jerusalem in Acts 21 and 22. The tribune couldn't settle matters, so he sent him to the governor, Felix, in Caesarea, Acts 23 through 26. The governor, Felix, and his successor, Festus, couldn't settle matters, and Paul eventually appealed all the way to Caesar in Rome, and you see him cycle through those various governmental structures. Several historical points are worth considering before we read the text this morning, because it will put the text within its historical context, which is extremely important here. First, religious persecution in the first century had everyone antsy. Rome had expelled Jews on two occasions recently. In 19 AD, Tiberius expelled the Jews from Rome, and in 49 AD, Claudius expelled them. Keep in mind, this letter was written around 57 or 58 AD, so they're only about 8 to 10 years removed from the purging of a people group, the expellation of an ethnic people group. This was the situation. Second, instability had everyone edgy. Emperor Claudius recently had been murdered by poisoning. The murderer was his own wife. She murdered him in order to place her 17-year-old son on the throne, a man who was called Nero. He later would persecute Christians unmercifully. He would wrap them in beast clothing and feed them to wild dogs. He would set them on fire to light his gardens at night. And we find no evidence of that happening at the time that Paul wrote, but it was just a few years later it did happen. So the seeds were there. Everyone was edgy, and there was instability at the highest levels of government. Third, high taxes had everyone angry. Two historians, a man by the name of Suetonius and another man by the name of Tacitus, record exorbitant tax rates when Nero took office. Nero himself considered repealing them, but was dissuaded by the 300-member Senate. And so you have this iron-fisted Roman oppressive government that had people antsy, that had people edgy, and that had people angry. Into that context, God breathed these words. And here's what they say. I'll summarize it and then we'll read it. Obey your government. Respect your government, and pay your taxes. That's very simply what it says. And let me read it in God's own words. Chapter 13, verse 1. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval. For he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid. For he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For because of this, you also pay taxes. For the authorities are ministers of God, attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, and honor to whom honor is owed. Would you pray with me? And Lord, our prayer this morning is very simple. For those who have been regenerated by your Spirit and desire to live obedient lives, help us to obey even a bad government, and to respect even a bad government, and to pay our taxes as you instruct us, even to governments with whom we might disagree, and make us joyful in doing it. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The first piece of, it's not a piece of advice, it's a divine dictate. The first divine dictate is to obey your government. Verse 1, let every person be subject to the governing authorities. Let every person be subject, place themselves under the authority, submit to their governing authorities. And it raises the question, doesn't it? We go immediately. Why obey a godless government? That can't be right. Surely something is amiss here. He says that I am to obey a godless government. We don't have so much of a problem doing this here in America because our government is not as bad as most. But what about in communist China? where they crushed them under an iron fist, the Christians. But yet here the apostle says, let every person be subject to the governing authorities. Why obey a godless government? Paul gives three reasons. Number one, God instituted all governments. If you look there in verse 1, let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. I was listening to Alistair Begg, I believe it was on this very passage, and he said these words. I stopped and I wrote them down. Since government is God's design, then we have to accept that all government is God's government. The institution of government, everywhere, at all time, is under the sovereign plan and purpose of God. Now, to say that does not mean that government always does what is right, because it doesn't. That's Alistair Begg. You see, God has graciously granted the institution of human government to restrain sin, not to eliminate it. All government is God's government, not merely the governments we like. And we don't like to hear assertions like that, but we can't deny assertions like that. Otherwise, we're out of step with verse 1b. Those that exist have been instituted by God, even communist governments. We just don't like to hear that, but we can't change what the plain meaning of the words say. So number one, God instituted all government. That's why we obey even a godless government. Number two, God appointed government. Not only did he institute, but he appointed government. Look at verse 2. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed. God appointed government from on high to keep some sense of order among otherwise depraved creatures. Greedy men may corrupt the institution, but the institution serves a purpose even in its corrupted condition. I mean, think of it. If God removed all human governments from the face of the earth, and every depraved son of Adam and daughter of Eve who inherited the sin nature was free to do that which was right in their own eyes, and every son of Adam and daughter of Eve did whatever they pleased and was a law unto themselves, can you imagine what this world would look like? I mean, we think it's bad now, but give every man and woman and child their freedom to do whatever they want to do, and you see that they will destroy themselves within a decade, probably less. So we obey even godless governments because God instituted them and God appointed them. But there's a third reason, because God uses government to thwart evil in verse 3. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. You see, the greatest deterrent to riotous behavior is swift punishments administered by human governments. We see that even in our own times when riots are breaking out in the streets and the National Guard is sent in and the riots are almost immediately dispelled. Maybe they crop up in another place, but the swift judgment of the government stops it in its tracks. And so even godless governments we are to obey. Let me take you back to the year 1528. One of my heroes, William Tyndale, wrote a book on how a Christian should interact with the government. The book title was The Obedience of a Christian Man. Think about that title, The Obedience of a Christian Man. He advocated in that book the divine right of kings, the doctrine that God sets up kings and tears down kings, But God is above the king. King Henry VIII's second wife, and he had many, Anne Boleyn, was a Christian. She obtained a copy of The Obedience of a Christian Man. The king read it, liked it, and responded in this way, quote, "This is a book for me and all kings to read," close quote. Tyndale's title nails it. It's a matter of Christian obedience. Will you obey a government which is imperfect at best and godless at worst? Rome was both at the time of this writing. And when we read Romans chapter 13, our knee-jerk reaction is, I already know what you're saying, well, what are the exceptions? When do we not obey? And the reason I know that that's your knee-jerk reaction is because that's my knee-jerk reaction. See, we have something in common. We both have a sin nature. And when we're given a law, our first nature, our first inclination is to rebel against the law that we're given. So what are the exceptions? Well, I'll talk about the exceptions in just a moment, but Paul isn't concerned with the exceptions. He never mentions them. As a matter of fact, he's concerned with obedience, even to bad governments like Rome. So obey your government. The second divine dictate that he gives us is respect your government's authority. Now, the first one is easy enough. I can obey even if I don't like obeying. But here he says you obey with a happy heart, as we say in our home, or you respect the one that you're obeying. Verses 3b to 6 give us this point. Verse 3b says, "Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do good and you will receive his approval." But here again we ask, why respect a godless government's authority? It just doesn't seem right. Why respect a godless government imposing their will on Christian people? Well, Paul gives us three reasons. Number one, government restrains the full onslaught of human depravity. Verse 4. "For he is God's servant for your good." He being the government official or collectively the government itself. "He is God's servant for your good." Now that may seem surprising to you, but even the pagan king Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon is called God's servant. If you go over there in Jeremiah chapter 43, verse 10, you'll find that is true. Evil governments serve God by restraining the full force of human wickedness, even wicked governments. I know this is challenging some of our preconceived notions, but this is the scripture. We just can't change what it says. We have to deal with it and submit to it. Secondly, he says, God uses government to execute earthly wrath on human depravity. Why respect a godless government's authority? Because God uses the government to execute earthly wrath on human depravity. Look there in verse 4. God gave human government the authority to, quote, "bear the sword," close quote, and also to, quote, "carry out God's wrath," close quote, as they administer justice. We go back to Tyndale in the 1500s. He opined, "The king," quote, "is ordained to take vengeance and hath a sword and not a peacock's feather." He's got an instrument and it's called a sword, and God has given him the divine right to bear that sword. Why? To execute earthly wrath on human depravity. The legal system in 18th century England understood this. When the criminal judge, not the judge who is a criminal, there's a lot of those, but the criminal judge presiding over a murder case, a death penalty case, when he came to read the death penalty, here's how he read it in 18th century England. "The sentence of this court is that you be taken to the place of execution and there be hanged by the neck until ye be dead. Period. And may God have mercy on your soul. What was he saying? That legal system was saying that that human judge had been given the authority to bear the sword and to carry out God's wrath on the murderer and to exercise capital punishment. One of the reasons that we respect a godless government's authority is because God uses even godless governments to execute his earthly wrath. And they will be held accountable to him. You say, well, they don't do it right. Okay, they will be held accountable on the final day to him. And those who are in government positions, this text calls them to a higher standard. They will be judged by a different standard because they have been given much responsibility and therefore much is required of them, even if they are wicked. So they will have their day. But the third reason he gives for respecting a godless government is because government's authority comes from God, and your conscience now knows this is true. You might not have known it before today. You might not have known it before you read these verses, but now you do, and your conscience will bear you witness. The blood is on your head, the blood is on your hands, and the blood is on your conscience if you rebel against the government without cause. And we'll talk about proper cause in a moment. But Paul again is saying, if you didn't know God instituted human governments and that you should respect them, you do now. Therefore, disrespecting their authority becomes a conscience issue. If there were any doubt about this principle, that God gave even wicked governments temporal authority, you only need to look to the Lord Jesus Christ. He stood before Pontius Pilate himself, and he stated these words, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given you from above." What is Jesus saying? The only thing Pilate is allowed to do is what God allows him or permits him to do. And that God had ordained Pilate for that time and that place and for that purpose. Read it in John chapter 19, verse 11. These are hard truths because government takes away our rights, and we don't like anyone or anything to take away our rights. But we are to obey our government, we are to respect our government. And if I haven't gotten myself in enough hot water, let me just go ahead and jump in the boiling pot. Pay your taxes. Pay your taxes. The apostle says in verse 7, pay to all what is owed to them. Taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. Say, I don't want to pay my taxes to a government that funds abortions. Jesus did. He paid his taxes, and in Rome, they were having abortions. Look at the history. They were having abortions by the boatloads in those days. Pay your taxes. Paul uses two words for government funding here. He uses the word taxes and he uses the word revenue. Two different words in the Greek language. Taxes in first century Rome were direct taxes on individual wealth based on the census. Okay? Revenues were indirect taxes. We call them today hidden taxes. At the time Paul wrote this, let me just give you a quick listing. You had a sales tax of 1 to 3% depending on where you lived. You had an inheritance tax of 5%. You had a slave tax if you sold a slave and you received monetary compensation, you had to pay 4%. Litigation, you take someone to court, you pay a 2.5% tax. Tariffs, 12.5%. They had taxes on edibles, on land, on any product made, on any service rendered. They even taxed prostitution. And I have a carnal mind to call for a flat tax or sales tax even today so that we can tax all the sins that we don't like. Those guys get off tax-free. Why don't we just tax them? They did in Rome, but that's my carnality coming through. You think about it, it must have been off-putting for the Jew to pay all of these taxes to an emperor who considered himself a god, demanded to be worshipped as such, and in recent history had expelled that people group two times. And yet, the Jew is saying, Paul says to pay taxes, and it's worse. About 10 years after Paul wrote this, a tax was imposed on Jewish people, on an ethnic group. Think of it. I mean, the thought is just mind-blowing that we would pick out a group and we would tax them just because they are of a certain ethnicity. Well, why would they do that? Well, they did it because about 10 years after this letter was written, the Jews attempted to revolt against the Romans in what is called the First Jewish-Roman War. They were thwarted in their effort by the iron-fisted Roman government, and then the government imposed upon them what is called the Fiscus Judaicus. It's the tax on the Jews. And yet Paul's words say, keep paying taxes to them. But Paul goes even further. Not only do you pay monetary, financial contributions, well, they're not contributions, but taxes, but he says that you also pay honor and respect. Look there in verse 7. You pay them the money, but you do it with honor and respect, even if you disagree with some of the things that they're doing. They're accountable to God. You're accountable to obedience. And those things need to be kept separate. Well, that's enough. I think I've got myself in trouble, so let me back up just for a moment and say, this discussion actually began in chapter 12, verse 1, when Paul said, present your bodies as a living sacrifice. Remember that? Part of being a living sacrifice is submitting to governments you might not agree with, paying taxes to them. Paul never suggests we only follow capitalistic free market democracies. In fact, he probably didn't even know what that was. That type of government didn't exist in his day. Rather, he says, all human governments operate under God's sovereign plan and purpose, and bad government is better than no government at all, for all the reasons that we just laid out. So what do we do with this? Let me give you several applicational principles. I just want you to think through these. First, recognize this. No government is exclusively Christian. We get the mind that only free market capitalistic governments are Christian. It's not true. And some of my theonomist friends will disagree with me. They think that Christians should take over all human governments and that that will initiate the second coming of Christ. They're also called in present day dominionists, dominion theology, or some of you know it as the NAR movement, the New Apostolic Reformation movement. But chapter 13, verse 1 says that those governments that exist have been instituted by God. It doesn't mean that we can't insert ourselves into that process, whatever government it might be. But it says that we are not to take over the government, but the government has been instituted by God. We are to contribute. We are to obey. We are to respect. But we are not to take over. King Jesus is returning for that. He's going to set up a once-for-all Christian government, which will be perfect. And he will rule with a rod of iron, and the government will be laid upon his shoulders. I believe it will be a visible, personal reign of Christ on this earth for 1,000 years. But others who are all millennial believe that it's going to be eternity in heaven. Whatever the case, until then, some governments are friendlier to Christians than others, but we mustn't think of governments as Christian or non-Christian. They're necessary to restrain sin and for God to use them to execute his wrath on evildoers. Second, generally speaking, again, not an absolute statement, but generally speaking, government creates stability and an environment in which the gospel can spread more rapidly. Think about what I'm saying. Government stability creates an environment in which the gospel can spread more rapidly. But that stability depends on citizens who obey, respect, and pay their taxes so the government can operate. That stability often provides stable environment, and a stable political environment, but also a stable economy, which is extremely important for gospel proliferation. We don't like to talk about money. We don't like to talk about the economy here because we're very spiritual. But the fact of the matter is, it takes money in this world system to get more places and to get more gospel distribution. And when a government is stable, the economy is typically stable, which means the gospel can more freely go out. But that depends on whether we will be obedient, respectful, and pay our taxes. Third, it's hard to win secular nations to Christ if you're constantly declaring war on them. Calvin recognized this during the Reformation, which is why he dedicated his systematic theology called the Institutes to the King of France. He was about 27 years old, and his systematic theology is about that thick. But if you open it up to the dedicatory page, he writes to the King of France personally, and he says these words: "The characteristics of a true sovereign is to acknowledge that in the administration of his kingdom, he is a minister of God." Calvin had read these verses, and he wrote to the King of France and said, "You are a minister, in a certain sense, of God on this earth." And Calvin also had a warm letter-writing relationship with King Edward VI in England. He became very frustrated when some Protestant reformers in England, specifically John Knox, began rebelling against the king over religious freedoms. John Knox is a good guy. He's on the home team. He's a Christian man. But he said he had had enough, and he began rebelling against the king. And it frustrated Calvin because Calvin was making inroads through letter writing with King Edward VI. And it cooled the king in that relationship. He cut it off. Calvin had been working so hard to win him to Christ because he felt, if I win the King of England to Christ, then the gospel will spread more rapidly in England from the top down, you see. So it's hard to win a secular nation to Christ if you're constantly declaring war on them. And I feel like sometimes we declare war within our own country when we ought to be winning them to Christ. But it all goes back to our rights, right? I don't like my rights to be taken away. Fourth, a living sacrifice means we are obedient even when we don't like the government. Paul later will write to Timothy these words: "First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way." So he recognized that an obedient Christian community would allow stability and we could live peacefully. Keep in mind, he was incarcerated when he wrote those words and had been for 2 years. If I were Paul, I would be saying, it's time to rebel. Bust me out of the pen. I'm ready to fly the coop. But Paul had an insight into the wisdom of God that we don't often have here in our day. Peter was the same. He wrote, "Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good." And most people believe Peter wrote those words to people, Christians who had fled Rome due to Nero's vicious persecution of Christians. We need to obey and respect our government. We need to pay taxes. Is there ever a time to disobey? There is. Paul advocates obedience here but he doesn't advocate blind devotion. The Old Testament records several examples of civil disobedience. Paul, being a Pharisee, would have memorized the Old Testament. So clearly he knew each of these examples. Let me tick them off for you. Exodus chapter 1, the Hebrew wives, the Hebrew midwives, defy Pharaoh's order to perform abortions. Joshua 2, Rahab defied the king's order to produce the Hebrew spies. 1 Samuel 14, the people defied King Saul's order to kill his son Jonathan for breaking a vow. 1 Kings 18, the prophet Obadiah defied Jezebel's wishes to kill God's prophets, Jezebel being the queen at the time. Daniel 3, Daniel's friends refused to worship an idol. Daniel 6, Daniel himself refused to pray to the king. Acts chapter 5, Peter defied the religious authorities when he wouldn't stop preaching Christ. And in those days, the religious authorities held some manner of civil authority as well. And then in Revelation 13, verse 15, we read that Christians will defy the command to worship the beast. True Christians will. Based on these examples, Christians must be prepared to disobey if the government requires us to violate a clear command in Scripture. They dictate that we worship idols, if they dictate that we murder anyone, and especially babies, or if they violate a clear moral imperative, such as Rahab giving up the spies because they would have been executed, or Obadiah giving up the prophets of God because Jezebel wanted to execute them, then we have some license to disobey the government in those rare cases. These exceptions are not as black and white as we might prefer them to be, and we must exercise deep, deep wisdom and prayer and caution before deciding to actively disobey. We dealt with this in real life terms during the COVID crisis, where our state officials issued a mask mandate as well as our federal officials, and we abided by those. Thankfully, we live in an area where we have a Christian-minded governor. Whether she's a Christian, I do not know, but she's Christian-minded nonetheless. And they shut us down for over a month. And we abided by that because we felt it was reasonable in the interest of public safety. And they opened us up as quickly as they felt it was safe and to do so. But I'll tell you that my brothers and sisters in California were, and still in some places are, by government dictate, not permitted to worship, either in public or even to gather together in their homes. And the Supreme Court struck that down here recently in the last week or two. But it ought to cause righteous indignation for those of us on the East Coast who have more or less perfect freedom of religion and to exercise our religion and to worship freely. And we don't have a care in the world about our brothers and sisters in California. And John MacArthur's church is at the forefront of it, but there's a whole host of churches underneath his that still are being persecuted by their government, and it doesn't even cause us alarm. It doesn't even fill us with a righteous indignation. We just go on to the next event in our lives as if nothing's happening. It's coming. We will have to deal with Romans 13 soon, very soon. And as the hostilities toward Christianity in particular begin to come to us, we will come together, probably in this very room or maybe in our new location. We will have deep prayer. We will have deep discussion. We will come to terms together amongst ourselves if we need to disobey and rebel against our government, but we won't do it haphazardly, and we won't do it on a whim, and we won't do it just because I say we do it. We'll do it together as a congregation. These matters are not black and white. In every instance is its own situation and a case unto itself. But we need to come back to this text and remember, Paul didn't emphasize the 1% of the time we disobey the government. He emphasized the 99% of the time when we obey. That's the point of this passage. As it relates to our congregation, let me just close this way. As I thought about this, I thought, you know, I would hate, and I think that's the right term, is I would hate this if this were true. I would hate it if a few of us disobeyed the government or disrespected the government or cheated on our taxes to save a few measly dollars. I would hate it if we did that. And because of that, God withheld his blessing from this congregation. That would be a travesty. It may be that we have not reached nearly close to our maximum potential simply because we want to save $100 on a tax return. Wouldn't it be sad if God held back his blessings from First Baptist Church of Springville over such an issue as juvenile as this one, $100 on a tax return? I'm not saying take advantage of every tax loophole. I do. But I do it within the law. And I pay what I'm supposed to pay. You say, somebody gives you $100 for a funeral. I bet you don't write that down on your taxes. You better believe I do. I keep my own records and I put that in and I count that as income because it's a service rendered. Every stinking nickel I receive, because I'm not going to allow God to hold this church back. Well, I can't allow God to do anything, but it's not going to be my fault because I tried to save $100 by not reporting it on my taxes. Come on, we got to get past that. We're better than that. And I think God has much in store for us. Who knows what he would do if we all submitted ourselves in Christ-likeness to our governing authorities, much less if we submitted ourselves one to another. Obey your government. Respect your government. And pay those taxes. Let's pray.